MedCram.com.
Well, welcome to another MedCram video. We're going to talk about the adrenal cortex today. And the first thing we've got to learn about is the anatomy. Adrenal cortex is part of the adrenal gland, which sits right on top of the kidney. And you know you've got two kidneys, one on each side of your body. And right above the kidney is this little triangular-shaped organ called the adrenal gland. And it's got two areas. It's got a medulla, which is in the middle, and it's got a cortex. And that's what we're going to talk about today, is this cortex, this outer portion of the adrenal gland. So let's zoom in a little bit on that and talk about it. Okay, so the adrenal cortex is a big triangle, if you will. And we're just going to sort of ignore the middle portion, which is the medulla. The adrenal cortex is divided into three layers. There's the outer layer, okay, and then there's an inner layer. And the part that gets left over is the middle layer. So there's three layers, basically. And those three layers, of course, has a name. And the first layer, the outermost layer, is known as the zona glomerulosa. The middle layer is the zona fasciculata. And the last layer is the zona reticularis. So from outer to inner, it's GFR. It's a nice way to remember it. Zona glomerulosa, zona fasciculata, zona reticularis. We'll talk about each of these three layers. The other thing I want you to know is the type of hormones, which is what the adrenal cortex secretes. What type of hormones they secrete? They secrete steroid hormones, and that's important to know that, because there are some hormones that are proteins, they're peptides. So why is it important to know that this secretes steroid hormones? If you take a look at the structure of the type of hormone that it secretes, they're all derived from cholesterol. And the reason why that's important is because these hormones are lipid soluble because they're a steroid. Now, because of that, they're able to go in through the cell into the cell's nucleus. Now, why is that important? It's because these hormones affect transcription of proteins in the nucleus. And that causes proteins to be made that can then be exported. Now, why that's important is because normally when you have hormones that are proteins, those proteins that are secreted into the blood will hit a receptor on the surface of the cell, which will cause something to happen almost immediately. So protein hormones cause changes to happen very quickly, whereas steroid hormones, which is what we're going to talk about here, cause changes that will happen slowly, more slowly, maybe over days or even longer. Because these hormones actually go into your cell's nucleus. They cause transcription of different proteins, which takes a long time. As you recall, you have to have transcription, then it goes to the rough endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi apparatus, and then gets exported. So we'll talk a little bit more about that. So if you remember our three layers, we'll just call them here the zona glomerulosa, the zona reticularis, zona fasciculata, and the zona reticularis. Now, if you're actually to look at this linearly, if you take a slice of the adrenal cortex, you would see that the bulk of the adrenal cortex is actually made up of the zona fasciculata, about 10% up here, and the other 10% down here. Okay, so the fasciculata makes up the major portion. So what are the major hormones that are coming out of this? The major hormone out of the zona glomerularis, the zona glomerulosa, is aldosterone. We'll talk about that. The major hormone out of the zona fasciculata is cortisol. And the major hormone coming out of the zona reticularis are androgens. The biggest one is testosterone. Okay, so aldosterone is what's known as a mineral corticoid, and cortisol is what's known as a glucocorticoid. So there you have it. So the zona glomerulosa makes mineral corticoids, specifically aldosterone. The zona fasciculata makes glucocorticoids, mainly cortisol. And the zona reticularis makes androgens, primarily testosterone. The way I like to look at, and this kind of brings up a nice point here with problems with these, and we'll talk pathology in a little bit, but let me sort of talk about what these do. So what does aldosterone do? Aldosterone works primarily at the distal convoluted tubule. Okay, so it's right there. And what does it do there? It causes reabsorption of sodium and dumping of potassium and protons. That's what it does. What does glucocorticoids do, or cortisol? Cortisol basically is a hormone that signals to the body that we need to increase glucose. Without cortisol, you would be dead, basically. You need to have cortisol. It just sort of makes the whole body run smoothly. One of the primary functions is to increase glucose in the body. And it can do that through gluconeogenesis or glycogenolysis. Okay? Androgens. What do androgens do? Basically, it's the male secondary characteristics. It's also responsible for sex drive in women. This is, in fact, women's only source of androgens is from the adrenal cortex. So knowing these things, knowing these functions, and remember, these are steroids, so they're going to go into the cells. So how would aldosterone work? Aldosterone would be secreted from the zona glomerulosa. It would then go over to the distal convoluted tube cells. It would go into their nuclei and tell the nuclei to make little sodium potassium pumps that would then be exported to the surface. Again, these are steroid hormones. So what's telling this organ to do all of this? Well, the major one is, what's stimulating the zona glomerulosa to make aldosterone? It's potassium, high potassium. So high potassium tells the zona glomerulosa to make aldosterone, and that's what happens. What's stimulating this? A substance called ACTH. ACTH is a peptide or a amino acid protein hormone that is secreted from the pituitary. Okay? There's also a little fragment that is made as well that has as part of it, and this will become important later, something called melanocyte stimulating hormone. We'll talk about that in a little bit. That's nothing really need to know too much about at this point. What stimulates this? Again, ACTH. Okay? And there's a negative feedback inhibition. So ACTH stimulates the fasciculata, and ACTH also stimulates the reticularis to make androgens and cortisol. If, for some reason, this is not doing its job, you're going to get more ACTH. Why is that? Because cortisol is going to backfeed on ACTH to reduce it, and androgens the same way on ACTH. Obviously, if aldosterone is causing the potassium levels to go too low, it's going to also negatively feedback on it. Okay, so we'll talk a little bit more about that in a little bit. Okay, so let's just review again. We've got the adrenal cortex. Okay, it's made of three layers. And we know what they are from the outside in. It's G, F, R. We know it stimulates the outer layer. The thing that stimulates the outer layer is potassium. Okay, and what does the outer layer make? It makes aldosterone, which works at the distal convoluted tubule of the nephron. The inner layer, the fasciculata, is stimulated by ACTH, and that middle layer, that fasciculata, is going to make cortisol, and the inner layer is also stimulated by ACTH, and it makes testosterone. Okay? Now, if there's a problem, Let's say that we could have a problem here with the adrenal gland. Let's say the adrenal gland's not working. What would it look like? Let's say none of the layers are working. Since there's no aldosterone, we can't dump potassium. So you would see that potassium, by the way, this is called Addison's disease. So in Addison's disease, this is where you have no adrenal glands working. You would see what? You would see an increase in potassium. because aldosterone's not working. What else does aldosterone do? It causes dumping of protons. So you would have a metabolic acidosis, okay? Because you're going to not be able to dump that. And you're also not going to be able to reabsorb sodium, so your sodium would be low. What else would you see? Your cortisol level is not going to be working, so you're going to see decrease glucose. Especially in stressful situations where you need glucose to do flight and fight, you're not going to have it. And then finally, lack of testosterone, which really doesn't cause that much of a problem, at least acutely. So what are you going to see in Addison's disease? Hyperkalemia, metabolic acidosis, hyponatremia, and hypoglycemia. And you also see, because of that low sodium, you're going to have low blood pressure. That's the big problem. Let's go to the other side. What happens if you have too much of this going on? Well, you could have that from something called Cushing's. Now, it's called Cushing's syndrome there's Cushing's disease and there's Cushing's syndrome. What's the difference between the two? Well, Cushing's syndrome would be from any cause. Cushing's disease would be if there's too much ACTH from the pituitary. So disease is if there's too much ACTH. Syndrome would be just too much steroids. Maybe you're getting it exogenously, like someone's giving you a cortisol or prednisone. So what are you going to see there based on this? You're getting a lot of aldosterone, so you could see a low potassium. You could see a low proton, that would be a metabolic alkalosis. And you would also see an increased sodium, which would mean increase in your blood pressure. What about cortisol? You have a lot of cortisol, so you'd also get hyperglycemia as well. And you also get a lot of testosterone, so you get secondary male sexual characteristics as well. Okay, so this is the highs and the lows of it. Also because of that, if you had a lot of this stuff functioning, guess what your ACTH would be? It should be low if you're not dealing with a Cushing's disease, if you're dealing with a Cushing's syndrome. But if in fact the pituitary is over secreting ACTH, then that would cause everything to be working overtime, and that would give you these syndromes that I was talking about before. All right, so join me for part two of our MedCram lecture on the adrenal cortex.